Thank you for that very warm welcome. You may be seated. You know, each time I come here, you know, it's always good to come back and to see familiar faces. You know, I think for me, one of the things that tells me about the health of a church is when you come back and you see same faces, but also you see some new faces. Same faces because it means that the pastor is not chasing people away, right? So congratulate yourself. Tell yourself, well, I'm glad that I'm still here. This is a very, very awesome church. And I didn't hear you congratulate yourself. Yeah, that's right. This is a very powerful church. And again, congratulate yourself that this church turned 5 years a couple of weeks ago. You know, it is my prayer that five is the number of grace. That in this new season of this church, in this year, we're going to experience some unprecedented grace. You know, where you were walking before, you begin to run. You know, your God will quicken your steps. You know, it will take you upon wings like the eagle, and it will do amazing things in your life in Jesus' name. No, if you believe that, shout a big amen. 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 You know, I really want to thank God for the leadership of this house, Pastor Atayo, Pastor Mo, and the other leaders represented here. You know, I tell you what, I mean, it takes a lot. It takes a lot to pastor a church. We take a lot of things for granted. You know, I was speaking to someone yesterday because we came into Birmingham over the weekend on Friday because I had another speaking engagement somewhere yesterday. And I was speaking to a pastor and he was telling me, man, brother, it's not easy. You know, it's, and I could really understand where it was coming from because ministry presents a lot of challenges. You know, they say that the heart of the pastor is always bleeding. And I just wanted to mention that so that we recognize and appreciate the pastors that God has given us. Pastor Mo, I've known for a very long time, like you said. You know, when I knew her, I wasn't even a Christian. You know, she's always been a Christian. I guess she was born a Christian, but, you know, I wasn't a Christian. I was still about town, you know, the boy about town, the very careless, playful, boy about town running after all the girls and doing all sorts of stuff. But I thank God for the grace of God upon my life that he has preserved me, to be able to be here. You know, I never imagined that I would be able to stand in front of people and speak. It was not the plan. I mean, come on. For someone that was just about playing, doing his own business, you know, some of you are seated here. You know, where God will take you to, you can't even begin to imagine it. You know, I look around and I see people that I can say look like me back in the day, you know. And you're here sitting and you're thinking, oh, yeah, come on, Pastor, just finish so that we can go and do our own business. You know, that's what we used to say. But God has a good sense of humor. You know, God would take the least likely person, you know, and use him to his glory. Tell your neighbor, I'm next in line. I'm next in line. Amen. 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 Pastor Tayo, oh God, I don't know how he does it. You know, I tell my wife that, you know, I've become so busy. But I even look at his own life and I'm like, I actually don't know how he does it. You know, so please pray for your pastor. He needs a lot of prayers. Not in a bad way, in a very good way. You know, just pray for him, strength and God's wisdom to be able to juggle and balance everything that God has put in his hands. So today, we're exploring the theme. I mean, the theme for the month is hearing from God. So today I've titled this message, Thus Saith the Lord. Thus what? And if you want a more, you know, contemporary title, you could say, did God really say? Did God what? Really say. Now the reason why I titled it Thus Saith the Lord is because, you know, like, if you want something to carry weight, if you want what you're saying to carry weight, you go, I mean, but let me give examples. If a guy is interested in the lady and he says he's been praying and he wants the lady to actually get a sense that, to not to be able to reject him, he will go to her and say, "Thus saith the Lord, you are my what? Wife." And then I expect the lady to say, "Thus saith the Lord, you are not my husband." But that's what people do when we want the word to carry a lot of weight. We say, "Thus saith the Lord," you know, and we give this sense that, I'm in the spirit and the Lord is speaking to me, you know, and when someone tells me, "Thus saith the Lord," it's almost like they've tied your hands. Because are you going to say the Lord did not say? You know, the only arena that I tell people that if someone tells you to trust the Lord, that you can say he did not, no, God did not say, is in the area of relationship. Because I can't, if you tell me to trust the Lord to go to Afghanistan, I'm not going to tell you that to trust not the Lord. Because I want to believe that you've heard God. But you cannot come and tell me to trust the Lord that I'm your husband. I say, "Sorry, my wife is right around the corner." You know, but you know. So I went somewhere yesterday, and the pastor was saying that one of the pastors there at the meeting was saying that one thing that they do in their church is that, you know, jokingly, that they tell everybody that you are only allowed 2 thoughts here at the Lord in a year. Now, the reason behind that is not so much they're not trying to say that the Lord should not speak to His people, but we don't want people to take it lightly. We don't want people to just, you know, use those words loosely, because once you say "thought seeth the Lord," you're putting a lot of weight behind what you're saying. As I get into the message, we just pray very briefly. Father, we thank you for your word this morning. We thank you for the hearers of the word. We ask, oh God, that you speak to our hearts. Lord, let your word percolate. Let your word take root. Let your word, oh God, Lord, go deep in our heart to God and transform us from within. Let deep change take place as a result of this word. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen. John chapter 10 verse 4. It says, and when he brings out his own sheep, he goes before them and the sheep follow him, for they know his voice. Now that is very important. It says the sheep goes before, the sheep what? Follow him, for they know his voice. If you're a Christian, you know the voice of God. You might not be able to always articulate it and actually discern it, but you're receiving the signals from heaven. You just need to tune in rightly, because God is always sending signals. Now, I'm acutely aware that in the age and time that we live in fact, not just this age, as God, since God created man from the beginning, the problem that we've always had is an issue of what God said. Let's go to Genesis chapter 3. Genesis chapter 3. When the devil was going to tempt Eve, what did she say? What did he say? In verse 3, in verse 2, he said to the woman, "Did God actually say, you shall not eat of any tree in the garden?" Now that's verse 1, actually 1b. Now that is important, because what the devil was doing there was calling to question whether God had spoken or not. And the truth is, if anybody can begin to confuse you as to whether God has spoken or not, you're more than likely to take the wrong turn. And that's what the devil said here. He says, "Did God actually say?" You know, many things have taken place. I mean, so many atrocities have happened. I remember watching on, was it on YouTube or Facebook, about a pastor in some African country who called his ministry breast and honey, exactly, breast and honey ministry, and what he said was that according to scriptures that he understood that women need deliverance, and the way the deliverance comes is by him having to suck the deliverance out of their breast, and people actually go to that church. crazy. You know? And the question is, the people that go there, do they actually even, do they know what God says? They don't have to hear an audible voice to know that that is not God speaking. So you hear many crazy things. There's another story that this is a very funny one about the gentleman that went to a lady, very pretty lady, and he said to her, "Thus said the Lord, you are my wife." And the lady said, "Oh no, that cannot be." He said to her, "Go and pray," you know, and then they met up again. And by this time, as they sat down, the lady said, "Are you sure that God said to you that you are my husband?" He said, "Yes." "Okay, well, now I have HIV. My womb has been taken out. I have this, I have that." You know what the guy did? He just took off. You know, because the point is, if you can confuse one with "Thus saith the Lord" or "Thus saith not the Lord," you can control a person. And that is witchcraft, whichever way you look at it. You know, God wants to lead us by His Spirit. He doesn't want us to be controlled or cajoled by somebody coming to manipulate the word in our lives. So, a few things that I want to just mention very quickly. Number one, God speaks. Some of us are in doubt as to whether God still speaks. God speaks. In Hebrews chapter 1, verse 1 to 2, it says, "God, who at various times and in various ways spoke in time past to the fathers by the prophet, as in these last days spoken to us by His Son." We are in the last days, friends, and Jesus is the express word of God. God still speaks today. Number two, God is very, very keen to get across to us. Some of us, you know, at times in our prayer time, it's almost like we are shouting and screaming out, "God, are you there? Can you hear me? I'm calling out, but I'm not hearing anything." But the truth is, God is forever trying to get across to His people. So if we're not hearing Him, or if it seems like we're not hearing Him, it's not because God is not speaking. After all, in the time of Samuel, right, when God called Samuel, in 1 Samuel, God called him 4 times. If God wasn't interested, if God wasn't keen on getting across to Samuel, He would have stopped the second time. God kept calling until somebody helped Samuel tune his frequency to be able to hear God calling him. Tell your neighbor, God is calling. Number three, God speaks in many different ways. And we'll come to some of those ways later on. Numbers chapter 12, verse 5 to 8 says this. It says, "Then the Lord came down in a pillar of cloud and stood in the door of the tabernacle and called Aaron and Miriam, and they both went forward. Then He said," as God said, "Hear now my words. If there is a prophet among you, I, the Lord, make myself known to him in a vision." Yeah, one. "I speak to him in a dream, too. But it says, not so with my servant Moses. He is faithful in my house. I speak to him face to face." There's not only one way that God speaks. God speaks in many different ways. We'll come to some of those ways afterwards. The other point that I want us to understand is that when we create the right atmosphere, God is always able to speak. The right atmosphere helps us to hear God clearly. 2 Kings chapter 3, verse 13 to 15 says, "Then Elisha said to the king of Israel, 'What have I to do with you? Go to the prophets of your father and the prophets of your mother.' But the king of Israel said to him, 'No, for the Lord has called these three kings together to deliver them into the hand of Moab.' Now Elisha said, 'As the Lord of hosts lives, before whom I stand, surely were it not that I regard the presence of Jehoshaphat, king of Judah, I would not look at you nor see you.'" Now, Elisha was angry here. He was angry at the kings. But for him to change the atmosphere, something had to happen. Do you know what happened? In verse 15, it says, "But now bring me a musician." And that's one of the reasons why before the word comes or before in church service, we have the choir minister. We have the ministration because what that does is that, wasn't that an awesome time of worship? That was awesome. Let's just celebrate, you know, the worship ministry. You know, that was awesome. And mind you, that wasn't just a group of people performing. You know, they took us right into the presence of God right there. Even though I really enjoyed the drummer, and you know, he's such a gifted young man. Let's celebrate him as well. You know, I was captivated by his gift. I kept pulling myself because he was just so into it. Now, but the point is this, verse 15 says, "But now bring me a musician." Then it happened when the musician played that the hand of the Lord came upon him. You know, when, if you want to create, you know, a serious presence, let worship go ahead. The next point that I want to make is having the right disposition is necessary if we're to hear God. What do I mean by that? In 1 Samuel chapter 3, verse 9, it says, "Therefore Eli said to Samuel, 'Go lie down, and it shall be if he calls you.'" This is after the third time of God calling Samuel. It says, "Go lie down, and it shall be if he calls you that you say, 'Speak, Lord, for your servant hears.'" Another translation says, "Speak, Lord, for your servant is what? Listening." So Samuel went and lay down in his place. Now, a few points in that scripture right there that I want us to see. Number one, Eli said to Samuel that, look, you have to create an expectation in your heart. Yeah, he says, when he calls again, he says, "Speak, Lord, that your servant is what? Listening." You see, when you expect that God will speak to you, and you're almost in that mode, you're more than likely to hear him. I'll give some examples a little later on. And then it says, so Samuel went and lay down in his place. You know, when to lay down in your place means to come into a place of rest. In the hustle and bustle of life, it's more difficult to hear God. But he said, lay down in your place. He didn't say go on the treadmill. He didn't say go back to the farm. He said go and lay down in your place. If I'm desperate, if everything around me is making a lot of noise and I'm distracted, you know, there is, for me personally, I would usually have to sort of pull myself away, find somewhere quiet to lay down in my place to be able to hear what God is saying to me. Some of us have to do that. Some of us have to find a place. And if a few things, something else that I saw in this part here regarding Samuel, it says, "Speak, Lord, for your servant hears." Now, there is a disposition of the heart, a humble disposition of the heart that makes it easy for you to hear God. You know, Samuel had to be in that servant disposition, and not in this context now, not in the literal sense of it, but in the disposition of whereby you put yourself down and say, "Lord, I'm all yours. Whatever you say to me, I will do." After all, a servant obeys the master's order. So if God is going to speak to you, you must present yourself as one that is humble enough to take and receive what he's saying and to obey what he's asked you to do. Amen? So then, how does God speak to us? And I'm sure that if being the theme of the month, we've already gone through the different ways that God speaks. But I'm just going to just share a few thoughts that I have come to understand in terms of how God speaks. My pastor usually teaches 10 ways that God speaks, but I'm just going to reduce it to just a few. Number one, the Rhema word of God. The Rhema word of God. In Luke chapter 4, verse 20 to 21, Jesus Christ, it was said concerning Jesus here, it says, "Then he closed the book and gave it back to the attendant and sat down, and the eyes of all that were in the synagogue were fixed on him, and he began to say to them, 'Today this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing.'" Now the point here is that the rhema, the word of God, there's a rhema and there's a logos. The logos is the print, the written word, as we read your Bible. But the rhema is a spirit life, or you know, the one that is empowered by the Spirit of God, whereby you look at the word, it's almost like a scripture jumps out at you. Or if you're not even looking at the word and you're just going about your business, and a scripture jumps out at you. I remember 2001, thereabout, was in a season in my life. I was in London and I just finished my master's in IT at the time. So I was not deciding, okay, what should I do? You know, like a lot of us, you know, you came in on a student visa, you're thinking, okay, what should you do? You know, should you go back home? Should you stay here? It was the IT boom. There were a lot of jobs here. But even though there were a lot of jobs, it was quiet for me at the time. Things were rough, extremely, extremely rough for me. I was living in a house that I was just squatting, just sharing with somebody. You know, I have some of those stories. I think I've shared some other ones with you guys before, but this is another one. You've not heard this one before. You know, so I was living in this house where I was sharing, squatting with some friends. The house was such a mess. And at the time, my dad wanted me to come back to Nigeria. My dad at the time was a deputy general manager at First Bank. And he said, come, I'll get you a job in First Bank. How many of you think that would have been a good prospect? You know, it really would have been a good prospect. And I was tempted, to be honest. But I wanted to know what God had to say to me. Because at that point, I was already born again. And I really wanted to get direction for my life. You know, there's a season in your life whereby, you know, dad says, come, and you go. But this season, I knew that now I had to beat the path to my own future. So I was there just thinking, what should I do? I was suffering here. The opportunities were there. So I remember where I was pacing in this living room, filthy living room, just up and down. And I had God just speak to me, you know, in the scripture, Genesis chapter 26. And that scripture says, do not go down to Egypt, but dwell in this land and I will be with you and I will bless you. Now, I wasn't thinking of the scripture, but it came to me as a rhema word. I cannot forget that word. I cannot forget where I was when that word came. That was such a rhema word for me. You know, God still speaks to them. Now, guess what? When that word came, you would have thought, yeah, everything is now sorted. Then the challenges came. But the only thing I could hold on to was the word. Because things got worse after then. Oh no, things got worse. For several years, I could not feed myself. As in, I could not pay my own bills. You know, for a number of years, I think you guys have heard the other story about this other house that I was living in where, so this one preceded this, you know, it was a very rough season. But what kept me was that word. But God is faithful. Because that word proved true. And that word for me, you know when, you know like some movies, they have part one, part two, part three, part four. And then out of nothing, they create part five. You know, I keep going back to that word because I believe that word is not finished yet. You know, because he said it will be with me and it will bless me. A blessing is not a full stop. You know, it's a continuous thing. So God just started something there, you know, and I expect that continuously is going to keep opening some opportunities for me. So at times when I'm discouraged, I just go back to that word. I never forget that word. Number two. Sanctified common sense is another way that God speaks. You know, you want to buy a house, you want to buy a car. You know, we don't really, I mean, at times, yes, I pray about that. The other day, I was saying to my wife that I want to change my car now, you know, and I was praying about it. But I also know that apart from praying, I also need to do some checks. I need to find out how many miles per gallon the car can do. You know, I want to find out whether if the car, you know, if the headlamp breaks now, that I have to import it from Germany. You know, you need to find out some of these things. But here is what scripture says about that. In James chapter 1, verse 5, it says, if any one of you lack wisdom, let him ask God, who gives all to all liberally and without reproach, and it will be given to you. So God gives us wisdom. Wisdom is the application of knowledge. So the point is that God has given me wisdom. I've asked him. Then I need to go about finding, okay, well, what do I need to make sure that this thing works together? I want to get married, but then I don't have a job. You know, I don't even know where I'm going to bring the wife to if I marry her. You know, but there are some practical things that all we have to do is that even though God has answered that prayer, the delivery of those things will not happen unless you do some practical things. So, if one of my mentees was actually with me in Birmingham yesterday, actually, he went back recently, you know, and we talk about relationships and all kinds of things. And some time ago, he was thinking of settling down, and I just knew that in as much as the lady could be the right person, and yes, the right person, but the timing just wasn't right. And all it just takes is wisdom. From my own experience, what's the point of making your own mistakes when you can get good counsel? And that's actually another way God speaks, but I'm going to come to that. You know, there are some things that we don't need to bother God about, that in practical ways, God has actually made a way for us. Number three, God speaks through dreams and visions. Joseph had dreams, Paul had visions. You know, in Acts chapter 16, verse 6 to 10, it says, "Now when they had gone through Phrygia and the region of Galatia, they were forbidden by the Holy Spirit to preach the word in Asia. After they had come to Mysia, they tried to go into Bithynia, but the Spirit did not permit them. So passing by Mysia, they came down to Troas, and a vision appeared to Paul in the night." Say, "A vision appeared to Paul in the night. A man of Macedonia stood and pleaded with him, saying, 'Come over to Macedonia and help us.' Now, after he had seen this vision, immediately he sought to go to Macedonia, concluding that the Lord had called us to preach the gospel there." Now, the way this would look in our time and in your life is that you apply for this job, the door shuts. You apply for that job, they called you, phase one, part two of the interview, you got there, but part three, they denied you that next season. And you're thinking, "Lord, what is happening?" You're not sleeping, but somehow God opens your eyes and you can see that there's something else, an opportunity for you here, you know, and you walk through that and bam, it's done. Now, the other day, one of the young ladies that works closely with me was saying that another girl was concerned about what she was going to do with her life. And so this lady that was close with me was now praying for the other girl. And as she was praying, she wasn't dreaming, you know. She just saw a flash. And what she saw this lady in an old nursing gown. You know those old nursing gown, light blue with this, you know, with that, I don't know what they call it, heart-looking thing, you know. And she just told me that, and as soon as she told me that, I actually knew what that meant, you know. So I didn't tell her what it meant. I said to her, she's going to pray and find out from God for clarity of that stuff. But for me, what that meant immediately, as soon as I heard that, is that that lady was trying to pursue nursing before, and that's where she's meant to be, but she's left it. But true to form, when we now met this lady again, she confirmed exactly that. People have dreams. Right? The other day, someone said they had a dream about me. And he said he saw me with an interesting dream, actually. I like that dream. I claimed it. Yeah. He said he saw me with two figures. This is money, right? One is, I think, 9 million, 9,000. The other one, I remember very clearly, he said 24 million. So I asked him, I said, "Do your dreams come to pass?" He said, "Yes." I said, "Praise God." Yeah. How many of you like that kind of dream? Of course. Yeah, but at times, dreams are not literal. You know, dreams are not literal. So I could get excited about that, but perhaps God is trying to say something else. And all I've heard and all I've run with is the 24 million, but it could be something else. You know, for some of us that dream, there are many books on dream interpretation. In fact, my pastor does a very excellent a series of teachings. In fact, we're actually going through one at the moment, interpretation of dreams. Dreams are God's way of speaking to us in the nighttime. You know, because when you're sleeping, your body is resting, but your spirit man is alert. So God is able to get to you. Maybe you've been running around all the days trying to speak to you, but it couldn't get across to you. But then it comes through in your dream. You know, I mentioned earlier that dreams are subject to misinterpretation because dreams are not always literal. But if you have a repeated recurring dream, you know, that is worrying or troubling to you, you want to speak to your pastor about that because God could be saying something, particularly if it's reoccurring. God also speaks to us through what I call the prophetic or prophecy. You know, and prophecy inspired by God will always strengthen you, encourage and comfort you. And by that, what I mean when I say prophecy, I put together a number of spiritual giftings there, the word of knowledge, the word of wisdom, you know, the sign of spirit. I put them all together under prophecy. You know, the other day, Pastor Mo was talking about the fact that, yes, myself and Pastor Tao do business together. And being through a season that has been just sort of challenging, you know, like you're pursuing a particular interest that it almost seems like is a moving target. And it gets very frustrating at times. But I was in church on a particular day and I was there really frustrated. Now I thought, God, you got to do something here. I knew that, yes, this is the way God wanted us to go. But at times, I don't know whether you're like me, you just need some confirmation. You need reassurance that, God, it's you on my side here. So as we're worshiping, God's presence was awesome in the service, you know, powerful. It was such an awesome service. Awesome. Anyway, so we called a few people out and I came along, you know, we're sowing a seed. But then right there in front, as I was there just worshiping and just enjoying God's presence, he said he could see a house. Oh no, that someone was building a house or wanting to build a house rather. And I just put my hand up. I said, that's me. That is me for sure. And I know that because I looked at nobody else reason. That was what was on my mind at that time. That was the burden on my heart. That, Lord, this thing is taking so long, you know. And the word came forth and he said that, yes, you know, that it might be taking so long, but God is using this to train you for the many other projects that you'd embark on. I mean, everything that's reassuring. That was such a word for me. And even though the circumstance did not change, but that word has sustained me because I know that God has spoken. Regardless of what door is now shut ahead of me, I know that it's just a matter of time because God has what? Spoken. So in 1 Corinthians chapter 14 verse 3 says, talking about the prophetic now, says, on the other hand, the one who prophesies, let him speak to people for their upbuilding and encouragement and consolation. I already mentioned that, the prophetic would always strengthen you, encourage and comfort you. Now, wise counsel is another way God speaks. I kind of tied out to the wisdom that I mentioned earlier on in terms of sanctified wisdom. But wise counsel, in Job chapter 8, verse 6, it says, for inquire, please. Tell your neighbor, inquire, please. Of the former age. And consider things discovered by their fathers. Now, this is very important. This is very extremely important. Particularly, we live in an age whereby, I call it a fatherless age. Whereby it's difficult to find people that will just submit to the authority of a pastor or a mentor for leading and guidance for their lives. But here he's telling us, says, inquire of the former age. There's a reason why we have to inquire of the former age. Because whatever you're trying to do now, they've done it before. They've got the t-shirt. Whether good or bad, they've made the mistakes. You want to get married? They've been there. You want to start a business? You want to leave your job? They've been there. You know, what is it that you're trying to do that they have that those of former age haven't done before? So you're banging your head against the wall, trying to find out, Lord, are you speaking or not? Some of these things, it's easy. Just as pastor, I'm thinking about this. What do you think? At times, it's a prayer point. Other times, it's just counsel. I tell you, counsel will save a lot of heartaches. Oh no, I know that for a fact. Counsel, getting the right counsel in relationship matters will save you a lot of heartache. Getting counsel as to which direction to go with your career will save you a lot of years in your life. Even with managing your finances. Well, we keep praying about this, but God never reinvents the wheel. If God has done it for one person, so far some of the things, they are in books. But if you tell somebody, go and read this book, they won't read it. But let's even say you're not reading it, but make sure you get counsel. If you get counsel, you are safer. I know that for a fact. I married late. But even though I thought I knew what to do, I still didn't take it upon myself to just flow like that. At every point in my relationship or in choosing who to marry, I made sure that my pastor knew every step of the way. Because I've never been married before. And I want to only marry once. Do you understand what I'm saying? So the point is, we got to get counsel. You got to get counsel. And praise God, has it been awesome in my marriage? Yes, because I got the right counsel. So it says, please inquire. For inquire, please, of the former age and consider the things discovered by the fathers. There are some discoveries that you don't need to discover for yourself. It's been discovered already. This, I'm telling you, God is speaking to you right now as I'm speaking. Some of us need to hear this. That's why I'm just staying here a little bit. Another way God speaks is inner witness. In Philippians chapter 4, verse 6 to 7, talks about, the peace of God that passes all understanding will guide your heart and mind in Christ Jesus. When at times when God wants to give you clarity on the matter, He gives you peace. At times, if God doesn't want you to settle on the matter, it feels like your peace has been withdrawn from that situation. You want to buy a house. You walk into the house looks nice, but you're just not at peace. Don't ignore it. I would say that's the point whereby you want to say, Lord, are you saying something? It's an indication that perhaps God is trying to get across to you. God also speaks through... Oh my God, 1 minute. God also speaks through still small voice, and I'm sure we know that. So I'm going to skip that. So why is it that we don't know when God is speaking to us? Why is it that we don't know when God is speaking to us? Number one, because our minds are too busy to hear when our spirit man is trying to transmit. So we're running around trying to sort things out, and we're just so busy, we can't even hear what God is saying anymore. Why is it that I can't hear whether God is saying that's my husband or not? It's because emotionally you've already been involved and it's difficult now to hear what God is saying. Number two, the reason why we don't know when God is speaking is because it does not seem to say what we want to hear. And Bible says in Isaiah chapter 55 verse 8, my ways are not your ways and my thoughts are not your thoughts. So it's almost like we have our own plan. This is the way it should go. This is the way I would get that job. But then if it doesn't quite work out like that, or if we're getting a sense that God is leading another way, we discard that because that's not the way we imagine that it would work. Another reason, we live in an age of rationalization. So the idea is that if it doesn't make sense, then it cannot be God. So everything in this age has to make sense. But then where do we then put faith? Another reason why we don't know when God is speaking to us is that we fear that we will get it wrong. We fear that we'll get it wrong. So you hear the voice and you say, get thee behind me, Satan. No, it just might be God. And because at times we made some mistakes in the past and we don't want to make, and that's honorable. But don't discard it if that thought comes back. I would say, bring the thought and ask your pastor, let's pray about it. Because God might be speaking. So don't allow the fear of getting it wrong, because what fear does is that it incapacitates you and you cannot then discern the right way to go. And the last reason why I believe that we don't hear when God is speaking is that there are too many bad examples. There are too many thus saith the Lord. There are too many pastors like the one I gave you earlier on, you know, that back up what they're saying with the word of God. And because of that, we have decided to throw away the baby with the bathwater. There are many atrocities, many genocides that have been committed in the name of God. That God said this, God said that. Okay, so how then do you know when God is speaking? I round up here very quickly. I'm just going to list a few things. Number one, when God is speaking to you, he never condemns you. Number two, it would always be in line with his word. Number three, it requires faith. When God is speaking, it would always require what? Faith. When God is speaking, it would always require what? Faith. If you can just reach out, stretch your hands and reach it, then perhaps you don't need God there. It requires faith. Number four, it is guarded by love. Number five, it doesn't come like a thunder. It doesn't come loud at times. It's just in that quiet moment that you can easily miss it. And then it has to be, I like to say that it has to be confirmed by at least two or more witnesses. So if you hear something that you believe is God, put it to the test. Let somebody else confirm it. And lastly, you get to know when God is speaking by reason of use. You know, a child that tries to walk doesn't stop trying to walk because he fell down once. You got up and fell down once and he says, I'm not going to try and walk again. A child learns to walk by continually getting up and going. So I say this because at times we've heard, some of us have heard some, you know, something, and it, perhaps it was God, but it was the wrong time, and we ran ahead and we got burnt, and because of that, we don't want to expose ourselves again. You know, we got to put ourselves out there. Walking with God is by faith. Hearing God is an act of faith. By reason of use, you perfect that relationship with God. Thank you. God bless you.